Worship the Lord here in a couple minutes. If you're a guest with us today, we just want to welcome you, say we're glad you joined us this morning. In the seat back pockets in front of you, you'll see little cards like this. If you're a guest, we'd love to know more about you and who you are. So if you'd fill that out, throw it in the offering plate when it goes by, that'd be great. And if you're a regular attender here and you've got something to communicate to us, please go ahead and use those cards. That's a good way to get us some information. And speaking about information, we've got a few things that we want you to know about. So I think we got a little video to run to let you know what's going on. Hey guys, Pastor Joel coming to you this morning. I want to give you the top 10 reasons for being on time for video announcements. So without further ado, here we go.
The number 10 reason for being on time in announcements, I would say they're as important as life itself.
The number 9 reason for watching video announcements is to see how Joel makes fun of me, Deb Heller, each week. Number 9 reason for watching video announcements.
And the number 8 reason you should be on time for video announcements is to know what's going on around here. For example, on July 3rd, we're going to have a great big celebration right here to celebrate our country's birthday with big inflatable rides, with concessions, with contests. Uncle Sam and Miss Liberty will be here too. We have entertainment and cornhole and basketball and pony rides and lots of fun stuff for the family. So be here. The fun starts at 6 o'clock and goes till around 9. And then come back on Saturday night to watch the fireworks. You can pick your own spot. Get a front row seat to watch the fireworks here in town.
The number 7 reason to watch video announcements is to see how many announcements Miss Cindy has this week.
The number 6 reason you should be on time for video announcements is that next Sunday is the last Sunday for kids to get their camp forms in, the registrations, to go to summer camp. So this is it. Get them in this next week or they're going to have to pay extra to go to camp. And we don't want that to happen. So get those forms in.
The number 5 reason why you should be on time for video announcements is because if video announcements don't work, we'll have to go back to listening to Pastor Joel talk on and on.
Number 4 reason to come early enough to see video announcements. What else did Joel do?
Okay, and the number 3 reason that you need to be on time for the video announcements is to find out that there's a bake sale today right out in the foyer. And today's Father's Day, so this would be a good time to pick up something special to take home.
Number 2 reason for being on time for video announcements, so my mom doesn't yell at me.
The number 1 reason to be on time for video announcements is I've never been on time for video announcements.
All right. Miss Cindy felt like she got betrayed by Miss Gail. Totally betrayed. And I felt like I got betrayed by Nate. So there you go. And Deb got betrayed by me once again. An additional thing to bring to your attention this morning. This bag I'm holding here, these are what we know of as crisis care kits. We can turn that music off if we really want to. That's okay. Crisis care kits. What we do as a Nazarene, we don't dance. Wait a second. What am I doing? As a Nazarene denomination, we pull together what are called crisis care kits. And what we do is we fill bags with necessary items, toiletry items, towels, washcloths, Band-Aids, things that people who may have been involved, devastated by natural disaster, difficult times, those types of things. We fill these bags and then we send these to the areas of the world that need them. And so we need to just keep replenishing those. And so this is a time where we're working on doing that. There's a table in the foyer that has bags, and I think you may even hear a little more from Pastor today about those. But we want to help out in any way we can. There's instructions in the bag with what to get. So if you can help us grab one and bring it back full, that would be great. All right, I think that's it for announcements. So let's take a couple minutes, greet the people around you, try and find somebody you don't know, be warm and loving today.
Don't get too friendly now. People may think you like them. Hi. All right. Okay, you can be seated when you're done greeting. If you're not greeting, just keep on till everybody has been touched by someone. We'll get going and people will keep drifting in this morning. Happy Father's Day to you. Just a couple of housekeeping details. I need some ushers that are going to help me, please. We have an outreach thing going on downtown this week. Saturday night, is it? Numa Fest. Is that this Saturday night?
Yeah.
The last Saturday night of...
It is next Saturday.
This
coming Saturday.
Okay, the last Saturday of June. And it's our musicians are down there, and we serve in lots of ways. So the ushers are going to man these, just helping fill up time slots to serve. We want to serve our community there. And Joel just mentioned these, I believe. Hold that up again, Joel, if you would. These are crisis care kits. Say crisis care kits. Have you ever been a victim of a tornado, hurricane, or anything like that? Had no power. These are kits that are ready with the essentials. If we're a few days without that, we send them out all over the world. And we want to participate, and I know you do. So I want the ushers to also help me, and we're going to start these all over. We just fill these and bring them back, and we send them, and they're low on them because they're sent out all over the world, so we want to help replenish. I know you want to do that, so they're going to start them up and down the rows. We had such a good response last time. Just spread them out. Don't leave anybody out. Choir, did you have an opportunity to get a bag up there too? Okay, so go all over the grandstand, and don't forget people coming in. I mean, don't just say, hey, take this, but say, would you like to fill one, okay? Together we can do so much to make a huge difference. And carry the load so that nobody has to. Which reminds me, we've got some kids here. So Cindy, would you come up here? This is Pastor Cindy. She's our kids director, and that's for elementary age kids. Gail Wright is our kids director for our preschool. But what we do this time, does anybody know what we do with kids this time of the summer? Does anybody remember? We have an offering to help them go to camp. All right, are you with me? How many of you have ever been to a church-based or Christian camp in the summertime ever growing up? All right. Cindy, tell us, you really pushed camp. I think last year we took around 40 to 50, almost 60. And tell us why you believe summer camps are so important for kids and why you make a big deal.
Well, I think summer camp's important because for myself, it was during a summer camp that one of the summer camps I went to that just really something clicked in my mind and my head and my relationship with Jesus. And I really think that when we have a concentrated time with the kids at camps, great things happen when they're around other kids from other churches as well. So I would love if every child would go to camp. But this year I have a goal of 80, and we're only about halfway there. And we've got 1 week left for forms to get in. And we do fundraisers to help kids go to camp. Last year, the most anyone had to pay was $30 for a whole week of
okay,
camp.
Okay, and yeah, what's the full registration price so that a child would have to pay?
For middle and preteen, it's like $138.
Okay, so did you hear that? The fee is about $130 to $40, and no child that goes from here has paid more than $30.
No.
And that's because it's not just this offering, but with the 4th of July outreach, just all the things they do, bake sales, and us supporting that, we are able to scholarship kids for that. Don't you feel good about that? That's like knocking $100 off of the camp price. And so that's out there for anybody who wants to go, but they need to get you need to get their names in.
Yeah.
Camps for everyone, so we've got room for that, all right? In addition to that, if you ever think, well, Cindy, I want to scholarship some kids because there's families that can't afford the $30 to have multiple kids, you can find her alone and say, I'd just like to do that. You can do that confidentially. And that's great, but I like what we can all do together. Have you ever tried to lift something heavy by yourself? But when we all lift it, my land, something that's so heavy becomes light, doesn't it? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to do what we've done. We're going to take some cash out of our pockets or whatever. I guess you could write a check if you do write it to Wooster Church, but to put it kids camp at the bottom as a register. And I want us all over the place. I want everybody to participate. If you can do a quarter, a nickel, if you can do a dollar, if you can do more strategically in a proportion with how God's blessed you, I just want you to get something out. Doesn't matter if you're part of this church or not. That's what it goes to. It doesn't go to the church. It goes directly to kids. I want you to just get it out and hold it. Kids, I want you to stand up. The kids that are going to be collectors here. And normally, on any given Sunday, Cindy ministers to about 150, more or less, kids every week. It can get up to as many as 200, 130. So what a great ministry. Kids, I want you to go all over the place, all over the building. Ushers and others, I want you to point people. I just want you to hold it up. I just want you to hold it up where you are. Everybody participating, giving something. And we're going to bless the kids as they go to camp here. And then, Nate, I'll turn it over to you, and let's have some uninterrupted time of worship. That's why we're here, to worship the Lord. All right. Very good. All right. Okay. Did they come up there? All right. Did you get the musicians? And then we go, that's why I say, I forgot my wallet. My wife has my wallet. All right. Don't we appreciate children around here? It's messy, but they're all over the place. We love them, children and teens. We love them. Okay. We've come to worship the Lord this beautiful Lord's Day, Father's Day, and we're going to do that with all of our heart. If you're new and if this isn't your style, that's okay. We just pray that this is the way we do it. And we pray that the Lord's presence will be here and you'll be touched down to the very core of your being, your heart. Let's lift him up because he's worthy. You can stand, you can lift your hands, you can be silent, you can be quiet, but let's make sure that our hearts are attentive to him as we worship him today. Take it away, Nate.
Holy is the Lord, the Holy Spirit. Worshiping in spirit and in truth. faithful one. Jesus Christ, the Son.
Guys, just sing this with me now.
Holy is the Lord, the whole earth sings.
Now the ladies sing.
Holy is the Lord, the whole earth sings.
All the guys again, come on.
sing that loud. Oh, I'm living for you. I'm living for you. Sing, I'm living for you.
Call out my name.
voice one more time.
Speak, Lord, I'm listening. I want to hear your voice. Holy Spirit, show your heart to me. Speak, Lord. Save the day, and oh. you so much closer. I need you so much closer. I see the cloud, I step in, and I wanna see your glory as Moses did. Flashes of light. Rolls of thunder, but I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid. Show me your glory. Show. Darkness surrounds you. As elders bow down, singing blessing and honor as they throw out their crown. I'm awed by this. I'm not. exalted in our prayer as we worship. I believe you are.
One more time.
Now your presence fills this place. Now your presence fills this place.
We exalted, we exalted.
We exalted in our praise as we worship. I believe you are me.
As we worship
that you are.
That's our prayer today, Lord, be exalted in our praise. Your word says you inhabit the praises of your people. And so this is about you. It's not about a concert. It's not about us. It's about bringing glory and praise to your name. That's what the great multitude in heaven is doing. Your word says they sing, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We worship you, Almighty God. This gives us perspective so we can live life between Sundays. We love coming together and lifting our hearts and voices together. We can do it anytime in our own way throughout the week. We love coming together in this way. May you be honored. May this worship be an acceptable sacrifice to you as we give ourselves to you, not just a song, but our lives, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for the wonderful songs of praise we've sung from Scripture and about the glory of the Lord. Speak, Lord, I'm listening. Continue to give songs to those that are creative in this body, that can write songs that exalt you. New songs of praise to our Lord. May our voices and hearts be blended. We lift them to you. These are precious people to you, Lord, on this special day. I thank you for them and pray your very best blessing upon them, knowing that there's not a need, not a concern that's listed before us that you're not aware of. We can worry or we can pray and we can do all we can do, but the fact of it is, whatever we're concerned about, you know more, you care more, and you love more, and so we cast our cares upon you. I know that's easier said than done at times. It's not there aren't struggle times as we go through wilderness seasons, but you are faithful. Always remembering, Lord, on a day like today, for some, this is the first season that we've been without a father, a Father's Day, and the grieving is there. Or for some of us, it stirs things because the Father wasn't there or there were things that weren't in place. But Lord, fill us with your hope of what you want us to do here and now and forward. We offer ourselves to you. Speak, Lord, we're listening. Speak your truth in a song, in a message, in a word, whatever it is. Speak, Lord, we're listening and we will obey you because we love you. That's not fear-driven. I love that line. I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid. Perfect love casts out fear, your word says. You replace it with hope and love. And we want to be walking, living examples of that. Lord, I thank you for everyone's here. I thank you for guests today. We honor them, and I pray that they would again just sense the Lord's presence and their hearts would be moved, that we would be embraced by your gentle hands and love. Now we come to worship you by returning your tithe and our offerings. It's an act of worship. It says, you're first, Lord. Not compared to what we used to do or what we're going to do, but right here now, you're first. And we tangibly give you the very first, and we return that, and we give generously, even in these times, whether it's crisis care kits, whether it's for kids camps, whatever we do, we give generously as we can to advance your kingdom. Thank you for the privilege of investing your kingdom. We'll never be sad, not a penny wasted. So use it, bless it, break it, multiply it, and may your blessing be released over these people as they are faithful. And may we see mountains moved. I pray in Jesus' name. And everyone said, is anybody glad you came to church today? Hey, before you guys go, Nate and Kathy, I really liked what you did at the wedding yesterday, that at the end, over the mountains of stream, but you did it a different way and feel. So I'm sure it's in a similar key. You remember what you did? I can sing if you love, whatever you did. Go in that key and let's just sing that happy song about his love forever. I loved it. It's kind of a fresh feel to a song we sung right here. Choir, stand up, and then after this, and you can ebb your way out. But let's just sing of this, over the mountains and the streams. Am I dreaming that or did I hear that?
We did it.
And it was a different feel. I like doing weddings just because I like to come and hear what the worship's going to be at weddings. Let's just do a little bit of that, okay? That's just a joyful song. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name today. We honor you.
plug my monitor in.
Yeah, get that feel we had going. I like it. Hey.
Does that sound like a wedding song to you?
It does to me.
Celebration.
Over the mountains and the sea.
Come on, sing it.
Your river runs without me.
Sing it.
And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth. And I will daily lift my hand. For I will always sing when your love came down. Over the mountains and the sea.
Everybody said, yeah. Is everybody glad you came to church today still? Thank you, team. Thank you, thank you, thank you for all you do. Keep bringing on the songs that the Lord gives you. I love it. I love it. I love it. Well, today I want to talk a little thematically about Father's Day, but it's a message that's broader, so don't think, I can check it off. You know, I'll strike this one out. But I want to talk about a concept that I think is even just these few minutes that we have remaining today. And I want to start by just going back to a symbol that I used several weeks ago, but I want to expand on it. How many of you have ever heard about Stan Hewitt Hall in Akron? Anybody ever heard of it? How many's ever been there? Unbelievable? It is. I remember going there with my youth group, different trips, and going through the grounds, and probably didn't appreciate it as a kid like I should have. But let me just tell you a little bit about it, and I want to get something from that I want to base this truth on today. I'm just trying to drive home one thought today, one takeaway. Stan Hewitt Hall, if you don't know, is a 65-room English Tudor-style mansion. I don't know how many square feet that is. I want to ask how many of you have a 65-room home, but they do. In Akron, Ohio. Construction began, if I'm not mistaken, somewhere around 1912, and it was finished in 1915. It was built by the Goodyear Rubber Company founder, F.A. Seiberling, at a cost, 65 rooms, of $150,000. By the way, did you know this? Not many did the first service. The Goodyear Company was not named after Cyberling, obviously, but it was named after a friend who accidentally discovered the process for creating hard rubber, but he died before the promise of this potential was realized, and so Cyberling named the company after him, and I hope he gave his family royalties too. I don't know about that, but he might have. This says something about the character of that man, doesn't it? Don't you think, Cyberling, that he would do that? How have you thought it was Mr. Goodyear? Did anybody? Or Mr. Goodwrench? Okay, it wasn't. When the mansion was nearly finished, hear me, the Cleveland-based architect, Charles Snyder, approached Cyberling and asked him to come up with a motto for the home. He said, since we've modeled this home after several estates in England, in Britain it's a tradition that the house of this magnitude has to have a motto that expresses the beliefs and the legacy of the family who lives within the walls and the grounds. He said, okay. He wasn't much into that. He didn't want the shields and thing over the grounds to have a bunch of symbolism. He didn't like all that stuff. But he thought about it, went away, and came back sometime later, and after much soul searching, Cyberling told the architect, he said, I want you to carve this motto over the door. And in Latin, the words say, non nobis solum. It means this, not for us alone. Not for us alone. It's still there. And so they had it carved over the main entrance, which is pictured there, so that all who entered could see it and probably ask about its meaning. How many of you know that's a biblical thing? You establish a memorial so that the children and those coming, they don't know what it means. Say, what does that mean? I'm glad you asked, let me tell you. The family, you see, always intended for this home to be a blessing to others, and they constantly had a flow of traffic through it. It was open to family, kids, grandkids, friends, dignitaries, entertainers, and business associates. I mean, they just had the run of the place. Listen to this, and all the household workers and groundspeople were paid generously in that day and time, and they were able to live on site if they cared to. Mrs. Cyberling insisted that the workers eat all of their meals together, family style, as a community, and they had their very own dining room. This dining area wasn't some remote place, but it was just lavish, as lavishly furnished as the rest of the house. Don't you love it? There must have been something rare about this successful family of six children and many grandchildren, and it was said that really it was built for the grandchildren, and they just ran all over the acreage and all through the house. Man, you could have some great games of hide and seek in a 65-room mansion, couldn't you? The family trait, it was written, the family had this trait of self-forgetfulness, not for us alone. That seemed to make name recognition inconsequential to them. They didn't have to have it, the Cyberling Tire Company. Goodyear. And then one of the writers wrote, who did a site, said that, by the way, we just toured that place, and we got there at 4 o'clock and on the end of a tour, and a man named Jason gave us a tour, and he was most phenomenal. I mean, he knew every detail and intricacy of the place. He showed us everything and told us everything. And they found out later that his last name was Cyberling, but he never told them what his last name was. He was just Jason. Not for us alone. Wow, isn't that powerful? Let me translate that for us today. James 1:17 says that everything good comes directly from God, and he never changes, like shifting shadows. Every gift, every resource, every blessing is not for us alone. If my father-in-law, Dixie's father, was here today, he would say, Nathan, preach to the people about selfishness. Tell them about the sin of selfishness that's destroying our country as we know it. Talk about that, because that is not where life fulfillment comes from. It comes when we get this into our noggins and into our heart that we're not here for ourselves. Have you been impacted by selfishness in your family, in your world, at work? Not for us alone. Not for us alone. I'm going to tell you, I've been speaking in over several months here, and I come back to a theme of This not for us alone. This is a tremendous statement about, and it's a key to living a fully surrendered life to God, first of all, and then to live for others. That takes us out of where we are. You know, most of the times we go into the sinkhole. Have you seen some of the sinkholes that have happened in the news because of rain? You know why most sinkholes come about in our lives? Because we get focused. And they may not come about because of that, but we stay in them because we get self-focused. Woe is me, 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 I. Listen, my friend, I don't care what sinkhole you're in today. It's not about you. You will stay in the sinkhole as long as you think it is about you. Your life is about God and others. Salvation itself isn't just to keep you out of hell. It's to get the journey going so more and more people join the kingdom of God that's ever expanding and growing. I come back to this statement. Thanks for being kind to my brother when he spoke here last week and for supporting him. And we hadn't talked about it, but he used that, what I've been saying all along. Remember, in this whole idea of not for us alone, I've underscored and magnified the difference of a committed life and a surrendered life. Committed life means I call the shots as long as it's good for me. I can make the commitment and I can withdraw the commitment. It means we keep self-control. You can be committed but selfish. What's in it for me? Got it? As long as things go my way, this marriage is the way I like it, I'll stay committed. But if you don't do what I want you to do, then I could take it away. But we've been talking about surrender all through the wedding thing. As I always change it every time, but I've been going through my notes and changing these committed words. I like the surrender words much better, don't you? Why? Because that deals with giving up control unconditionally. It's simply a life lived for God and others. That's the way to joy and happiness, isn't it? Lynn, just see you nodding over there. You're having the time of your life. She's had great jobs in Cincinnati and various places, but you're having the time of your life working for hospice. What's hospice about? It's really about God and others, isn't it? About pouring out. Does that bring you significance and joy? Greatly. How many of you know that God's ways really work, that His ways are best? When we do it His way, we're going to get His results. You want significance? You want out of your sinkhole? Listen, look, everybody look at me. I'm your pastor. I love you. I can get riled up, but I'm not mad. It's not about you. Get your eyes off of you. The most miserable people I know that are in the dumper have their eyes on themselves. Woe is me. I've been hurt. This has been done. Stop it. Bob Newhart's counseling member session. Just stop it. We're going to play that one day. I don't find any scripture that backs that up. I will put my eyes on myself. From me comes my help. Do you read that? In fact, if you're depressed, man, you look at yourself long enough and you're going to go in a deeper sinkhole, aren't you? I will lift my eyes to the Lord. That's where my help comes from. And He made it all. It's not about me. Listen. We can do that about spiritual aspects of our life, too. We can get focused on the good things, the grace things of Lord, and we can somehow get puffed up, and we can think it's all about us. But it's not. That's for others. Anything God gives us, it's for the kingdom of God, to advance the kingdom. Get your eyes off yourself. I want you to say in the morning, it's not about me, not for me alone, not for us alone. Man, is that exciting thing. This day, God, is a gift from you. It's not for me alone. I can't wait to live it for you because that means it's going to intersect with opportunity. Some things are going to happen today because I'm not here living for myself. What a cul-de-sac way to live. You know what I mean? You go down a road, you think it leads somewhere, and it says dead end, cul-de-sac, and you're right back the way you came. Not for us. I grew up with so much of the Word of God saturating my home and our lives. And I say this disclaimer right because I know what happens. I can see your body language. Well, Pastor, you can't relate. You had a silver spoon in your mouth spiritually, and you don't know how it was in my house. No, but my dad did, and he was a person of change because he said enough. I'm not going to leave my kids. I'm not going to beat my wife. That's what my dad grew up with, all of those things. I'm not going to rip people off. My dad said enough, and he sent it a whole new direction because he said enough. It's not about me. I'm not going to live where I am because all these terrible things happen. I saw this model in my dad. He wouldn't even allow me to be in the room when he was dying. I'm not going to be bitter about that. I'm not going to say, woe is me. I've been a preacher of the gospel. I've been raising these kids. My own dad won't have anything to do with me. He said, I'm going a new direction. And I think about that. I get overwhelmed on a day like today. I'm going to think, I would not be your pastor today. This church would not be built in this place. A lot of us wouldn't be here today if God hadn't changed all that in my dad's heart many years ago. If God hadn't gotten hold of Dixie and my marriage back in the 80s when it was falling apart, you know, in the ministry and all these demands, we wouldn't be gathered here like that. Do you understand? You understand why I get overwhelmed and I go, it's not for me. It's not just about me. What a miserable way to live. Am I against the gifts that God gives of all the scriptures? Absolutely not, but be careful. I won't take time to read it, but I direct you to read in 2 Kings chapter 20. Don't just stop there, but go back further and read about a very good king. I mean, it has glowing words, and I looked up some of those passages, and it says in 2 Kings 18, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as David, his ancestor, done. He trusted in the Lord God, remained faithful to the Lord in everything, carefully obeying the Lord, and it says that the Lord was with him, and he was successful in everything. Say everything. But do you know what happened? Somewhere along the line, he got his eyes off of the Lord and onto the stuff God had given him. He did. And I remember my mom used to read me these stories about Samson, about various people like that. And I wanted to rewrite the storyline of Solomon. I wanted to rewrite that because I couldn't stand it when their last years that should have been the best years were wasted years. And the sunset of their life, they literally turned away from the Lord. The one that graced them and gifted them and gave all these things. And so it was, Hezekiah had done great things. He revolted and refused to pay tribute to a king, and they attacked, and they were overcome. And God came to him and said, through the prophet, he said, put your affairs in order, Isaiah said, because it's time for you to die. You'll never recover from this illness. And you know how the story goes, that he turned his face to the wall. And I find it interesting that he prayed. Listen to what he prayed. A good man, good king. He said in verse whatever that is, 3, remember, O Lord, I have always been faithful. He probably should have said, Lord, I'm remembering here that you have always been faithful. But somehow it became about him. Figure it out. I've been faithful to you. I have served you single-minded. I've always done what pleases you. Then he broke down and wept bitterly. What's that mean, to weep bitterly? That's not weeping for joy, is it? It's weeping bitterly because it's about me, it's about me, it's about me. God must have had a purpose for saying, put your affairs in order because you're going to die. God must have had a purpose for that. But the Lord heard his cries and changed what was going to happen, redirected it, and he told the prophet, go back and tell him he'll live. That in not many days he'll get over this illness and he's to go to the temple to worship. And I find it interesting that when he gave that word, the prophet said, this is what the Lord, the God of your ancestor David, says. I've heard your prayers and seen your tears. And then he said, what did he say? He said, I'll add 15 years to the life. Okay. I guess I want to ask you this. If God saw your bitter tears and he gave you another 15 years, what would you do with them? What would you do with them? Well, I'm suggesting in most of our cases, many times, we just do more of the same that we did before. And the focus would, for a few months or even maybe a year or two, it might be different, but in time, it'd get the best of us and we'd get puffed up with the very gifts and blessings that God has given us. Be careful. Here's what happens. You read on the passage, and he did a no-no. He had an envoy from Babylon came, and they were a godless country and, you know, a great, powerful nation. And he opened up, and he shared all the secrets of the kingdom with them. He knew better than that. He knew he wasn't to do that, but he did it anyway. And the prophet came back and said, basically, this is what's going to happen to the kingdom. It's going to be destroyed, ransacked. And listen, I want to pick up. Listen to verse 18. This is a tragedy. Listen. In verse 18, this is the prophet saying, nothing will be left. He said, some of your own sons, your very own sons, will be taken away into exile. They will become eunuchs who will serve in the palace of the Babylon's king. I mean, these were people that had privilege living in the palace, you understand? And said, they're going to be carried off and they're going to be serving another as eunuchs. Here it is, verse 19. Then Hezekiah said to the prophet Isaiah, this message you have given me from the Lord is good. I heard my mother read that, and I reread it, and I go, what? Did he see something I didn't see? For the king was thinking. In other words, he didn't say this, but here's what he was thinking. At least there will be peace and security during my lifetime. You know what he did? He threw his kids, as they say, under the bus. He threw the generations under the bus. As long as I have the good things of God, that's enough. By this season of his life, he should have known better than anyone that it's not for us alone, but he didn't get it. And guess what happened? Destruction. I mentioned Solomon. One of the saddest stories that I know in the Bible, too, is how he, when he was so full of wisdom, God imparted wisdom, that he should have been at his best. He was at his worst. And in the sunset of his life, he turned his back and disobeyed God. Right? He had the gift of wisdom, but the gift of wisdom distorted him, and people were bowing down, and he was smart and brilliant, and America goes after all those things, but he didn't have the wisdom when it came to his spiritual life and heart. And let me tell you, you read Scripture, the tracks, the trail that Solomon left, and even Hezekiah, were very disastrous to those coming behind. Breaks my heart. And then I go back and just touch on King David, because the Bible is full of where God says in his word, I will do in such and such because of my servant David. And we're thinking, wait a second, David had a very imperfect life. No, he had a very imperfect life, you're right. But the Bible still says that he had a heart for God. He somehow got it that he wasn't just living for himself. He was not the perfect father. But somehow he got it. And I love what it says in Acts 13:36 from the NIV. Listen to what it says about David, referring back to him, just a snippet. It says, when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep. Do you like that? Does anybody here want to serve God's purpose in your generation before you fall asleep? Because you know what? If Jesus tarries, no matter how healed or healthy we are, we're all going to fall asleep one day. I don't know anybody here who's 150 years old. Okay, if God wants to give us 15 more years, that's fine, but what are we going to do with it? Are we going to fulfill his purpose for us in those years, or are we going to turn away from him? Just asking. I'm calling this a decision to live for not for us alone. I'm calling this a decision to invest your life well, to receive these rewarding words from the Father who knows and sees all. Well done, you've been faithful. I am so terribly concerned about the handoff between generations. What a shame for parents to run so hard and fumble the handoff and their kids and generations don't carry it on. We remember times of great teams in the Olympics that have run far and fast and well, but in the exchange of the baton, the race has been lost or disqualified. When I say something like this, this isn't because I'm thinking of a situation or two, trust me. It's because that's where my passion is burning for this house and the people that call this home. Listen, not for us alone. Here's what I'm saying. No matter where you are, where you've been, complete surrender, unconditional surrender to God will change everything. It'll impact your life. It'll turn your life in a new direction. And it'll impact the ones who are following you, that you are influenced. Don't waver, I'm here to say. Don't wobble. Now's not the time for compromise. Keep your paths straight. Keep your eyes on the Lord. Be faithful. You ever seen a race where somebody's collapsed just before the finish line? Huh? It's not about you. For goodness sake, get your eyes off yourself. There's kids watching you. They're taking their clue from you. You're doing school whether you're instructing or not. They're going to school on you. Someone gave me a devotional. This verse was lifted up. John 17:19 from the English version. It says, I have given myself completely. Jesus' words, for their sake, so that they may belong completely to the truth. Oh, that says it. I just want to talk to you for a few moments about leaving tracks, because you are. You are. You're leaving footprints. Yes, you are. And people are watching. And people are following, whether you know it or not. Not for us alone. please hear me. As we leave tracks, I want to tell you, we will never be able to lead others spiritually where we have not been or where we are not heading. We will never be able to lead anybody where we have not been or where we are not headed. We're not there yet, but we better, brother, be on the journey. I'm concerned about that. And so, men, fathers, but everyone, I ask you, what does your family see that you're dedicated to, surrendered to, controlled by? What are you driven by? I more than ever realize that at this stage of my life, at 53 or whatever I am, that I cannot live for myself. It does make a difference what happens in future generations that might be watching me or taking their clue from me. There are people who believe in me, and I want to be real and genuine, and that includes your kids and grandkids that I hug. I never want my wife or my children or grandchildren to be disillusioned and be sitting in the pews rolling their eyes because what I am not when I'm here doesn't match up with what I am when I am here. I know they see imperfections, and that's fine. But I want to be the real deal, don't you? Because it's not about me. I got to tell you that in my life, God uses my family to keep me on the right path, and that's a path that's headed towards selfishness, selflessness instead of selfishness. I feel responsible to leave tracks that lead those that impact those I lead and influence to the feet of Jesus. I need to leave tracks for them. When I was a kid, it was common. Have you ever heard it in the house growing up? Be careful, don't. You're going to track in. You're going to track in. You're going to track in. Track what in? You know what you're going to track in? Where you've been. You hear me? If you've been slogging around the mud, that's what you're going to track in. And I'm talking more about a living room and a white rug, and we put plastic down to keep the stuff off, shrink wrap. It's deeper than that. Listen, be careful where you walk and how you walk, because you're leaving tracks. And it's not just the stuff you do. It's attitudes. It's all of those things. Are we okay out there? Tracks always tell the truth about where you've been. I mean, we can skin it and grin it, but eventually the tracks are going to trace back to where we came from. Oh, you know what? I didn't hit this. Could you bring up that scripture in Isaiah 56? I'm out of time. I'm over time, but that's okay. I'm almost done. I was just reading this morning, just in where I am, in Isaiah 56 and verses 10 to 12. Yeah, let me just read some of this. For the leaders of my people are the Lord's watchmen and his shepherds. Now, I'm not just talking about pastors and leaders, but I'm talking about those of us that follow God, that have influence, okay? That's you, that's me, that's all of us. Listen. I feel like when I read this, I don't think, I just happened to read this morning. The Lord knew what I was going to be speaking, and he connected the dots. This is this morning. For the leaders of my people, the Lord's watchmen, his shepherds, are blind and ignorant. They are like silent watchdogs that give no warning of when danger comes. They love to lie around sleeping and dreaming. Like greedy dogs, or we could just say they're greedy and they're never satisfied. They are ignorant shepherds, all following their own path and intent on personal gain. Do you see it? Not for us alone. They don't get it. I don't want to be that way. Do you? Do you? Well, nobody's watching my life. That's a lie. Nobody. Yeah. You do have influence. Let me tell you a couple stories and I'm done. Are you okay? It's better if you're hungry when you eat anyway. Recently, Dixie and I and the kids got to go to a family wedding, and we like those times. I've been to enough weddings in my life, but I like it, especially when it's family. We just spend time with, and especially when we've ministered before, you know, Ron, when you go back and there's just good people there, and you're just overwhelmed. No matter how discouraging it is at times, you go, there are some good, God-loving people, aren't there? And a lot of you are here. But we had a great relationship there. You remember, Nate, the story, and Cindy in particular, the wife, the grandmother in this story, she had a major impact on you. You probably wouldn't be here if it wouldn't have been for her. Pouring into you musically and helping you to jump out of your skin and do things, and Caleb and Hillary as well. You remember Cindy, Hillary, Caleb? They're all three here. These are good kids, by the way. I love you all. Well pleased. They're not perfect, but they're good. Right, Tommy? Good stuff. That's my son-in-law. But since we've been gone, their family had a terrible tragedy. And I want to tie this in. This does make sense. I'm not gloom and doom. You know me. I'm an encourager. But I feel passionate about this. They had a tragedy in their family. And a boy that Nate and Caleb played ball with, and Hillary too, he was a young adult, I think not quite 20 probably, in his late teens, but about the same age as you, several years ago. He was going home, and he was a good kid, great athlete. I mean, a good athlete. I mean, he had pop in his arm. He could do it. He was turning into the place where they lived, their division, and a drunk driver going a high rate of speed went left to center and just smashed into him, and he died. He didn't die at the scene. He lingered, but he was basically non-responsive. Devastating. The family's very close. His grandfather knew it all but wasn't living for the Lord and was gruff, racist, just had a lot of issues in his life. His mom and dad, good people, knew the truth, but they weren't living, and many family members. And you know what happened through this? You would think that they'd get so angry and bitter and they'd be mad at God, but the grandfather, the parents, and just family member after family member came tumbling into the kingdom, and they're still in it. Isn't that incredible? You would have thought it would have destroyed them, but instead, that was years ago now, and they're still faithfully serving Jesus. And so I looked for the opportunity. I had a great relationship with this grandfather. He's tough. He's kid. We'd go back and forth, gruff, big man. I caught him alone. I called him by name. I said, Harold, I just want to take a moment to tell you how proud I am that even through the loss of this grandson, Cody, that was such a tragedy, that you made a commitment to Jesus. You surrendered your heart to him, but that you're still surrendered these years later. I said, it is such an encouragement to me. This big man, instantly, the tears came and he was choked up. And he said, Pastor, he said, I'm just sorry that it had to take this in order for me to make this decision. Now, I'm not saying for a second you figure out your theology about God causing that to happen. I just read a great scripture about that. I'll lay that one on you another time. Just this morning something hit me. But he said, our lives will never be the same, but I'm so sad that I didn't come sooner. Are you with me? Okay, here's my point. As I plead with you again, I know sometimes people get up, they think I'm reading your mail, or you think that I've talked with you, so I'm fashioning this message just to get back at you. I promise you I don't do that. If I feel that way, I try to go another way, because I don't do that. If you're feeling like somebody's reading your mail, that's the Holy Spirit. That's not me. Knows your business. Nobody's tattling on you. But here's my heart. We think like Solomon and Hezekiah that we can just go on and do the same things. And like Samson, we can break the bonds and we're going to have our strength. But someday our hair is going to be cut. Someday consequences are going to come down the line because that's what it's going to take. God's going to get your attention somehow, some way. And what I do as a pastor, I just do everything I can to lay a body in front of you, to do anything, to say, no need to go there. God can meet you now. Now is the best time to square things with him. Got it? It'll never be better than now. I'm not saying that this is your only opportunity or last opportunity, but I'm telling you, there'll never be a better time because things will never be any simpler than they are now. Now's the time. You got it? And I feel that urgency just to say, now's the time. No, I don't know. I may not understand, but God does. Now's the time to say, I'm not going to live for me, not for us alone. That's the passion that I feel. God will use the most tragic situation, and here's what I want to ask you. Direct this especially to those impacting homes and leadership. Are you just measuring the temperature in your home spiritually, or are you setting the dial? Are you the thermostat or the thermometer? God just called us to be thermostats. You know, when we're thermostats, we set the temperature. And I want to tell you, when there's a block of ice there and a hard heart, you can't change them and talk them out of it, but you can turn the heat up and keep it there, and that creates the best environment I know of for that iceberg to melt. God says, I want men and women who are going to take this seriously and realize it's not about you and set the thermostat at love and turn up the heat. And God said, set me on fire and watch God melt the hard hearts around. And you don't have to change anybody because you can't. Some of us are in marital issues. If you realize that you can't change your husband or wife, especially, listen, when you're in marital conflict, and if you become what God wants to be, a thermostat and set the temperature of the God's love in your home, you'll see some thawing out the likes of you never seen before, because God can do it. You can't. I don't know why in the world the couples that think that they have never communicated in their whole marriage think that they can communicate now in the midst of all kinds of trauma. You can't. You got to communicate this way first. And then God can turn up the heat. You understand this isn't a negative message, don't you? This is a message of hope, because you can change, and it can dawn on you like the sun rises after a storm in the morning, where you think the skies are so gray that it could never shine again. And the next morning, don't you know the birds are singing, the sun peeks over the horizon, and you just feel warm all over, and you go, there's hope, because that's God. Look at me. I'm talking with you, with young kids. I'm talking with you, grandparents. What are you doing to leave tracks that lead to the foot of Jesus, to the feet of Jesus? What are you doing? Are you living for you? Or are you living to realize it's bigger than you, not for me alone, but for those who are following? You see the chair. I call this my dad's prayer chair. I promise you, and I'm not exaggerating, pastorally speaking, this was always in our home from my earliest memory in Goshen on Garden Street, where I was born and came home from the hospital whenever I was able to understand and remember. This was a gray chair, and this coming in the right door and turning back into kind of a dining room, family room. This chair was in there with that lamp, and it had a gray weave on it, and it had these, remember that fringe stuff that was all around the bottom of chairs that would come unraveled? But literally all my life, I saw my dad on this chair. And this was one of the Bibles that he has worn out, and I treasure it. I keep it in a box in my office. This is one of the many of the Bibles that he wears that wore out. And I would see him in this posture, that silver lamp like this, that would, the arm would swing out over his shoulder with this tubular, circular, fluorescent kind of lamp there, bulb. I could see him with his glasses off and his nose plastered in the Bible reading it. And if I'd go and shower or bathe and come back, then I'd see him like this, at this exact chair, praying for me, calling out my name, asking God to do whatever it needed to do in him, because he understood that it wasn't just about him, but it was about my kids. And I think in spirit eyes, he saw the grandkids even when he didn't have them yet. Do you think I could outrun those prayers? Do you think I could outrun that example? No. Those prayers circled around me when I was on the ball fields and in the locker rooms, and I couldn't do my own thing because the Holy Spirit was hovering over me, because my parents assigned him to keep watch. What an example. The church board a couple of years ago had that recovered and brought it in at the end of the board meeting, and I treasure that, and I have great appreciation. You've heard me say before, here's the difference. Dixie's father worked at the Firestone Mansion for years and years. He took care, personal care of Harvey Firestone Jr. When he was about to die, before he died, he gave my father-in-law a Bible that was his, unused, new. It's pristine as it was the day it was given to him. Harvey Firestone Jr.'s Bible, big man, big title, big money. Here's my dad's Bible, humble little holiness preacher, faithful man. I'd go with my dad's Bible any day. Why? Because my dad got it. He understood it wasn't for him alone. Are you with me? I'm not mad at anybody here. I love you. I'm your pastor. I'm a shepherd. I got to be a witness, watchman. I got to shout out a warning. Listen, we've got to run hard, and we've got to leave tracks so that our kids can follow. And they can't wonder where our tracks are wobbling and wandering to. They got to know that they lead straight to the throne of Jesus. No matter where you are, it can change like that. The best thing you can do for your grown kids that are gone, or your grandkids, the best thing you can do is encounter and come to this conclusion. It's not for me alone. I'm going to live for him. I'm going to radically surrender. I've tried, but here I am. Amen. I want to end this way. Thanks for your patience. I owe you a few. I want the men and the fathers to stand quietly. I'm not going to embarrass you. I don't care if you're from this church or not. I don't care how old or young you are. I want you to stand. I just want to pray for you. Father, I've tried to do the best with what I felt like you laid on my heart. Take it from there and take it further. I don't have an axe to grind with anybody here. I love them and cherish the responsibility that I have here to be their pastor, even if they're here just for this day. We'll call it that. There's not a precious man here that you don't know about and understand, and that you haven't called to set the thermostat in their places of influence. And Lord, I pray for them as a pastor. I pray that they will know that it's not enough just to have a head knowledge of you, but to live not for ourselves but for your kingdom. We've got to have a personal relationship that where it moves from the head to the heart and it consumes the way we live. And Lord, I pray that all these men will come to a point of surrendering their sinful ways to you, but then to take another step and say, Lord, here I am, to worship, to bow down. I surrender myself completely to you. This isn't about an emotional moment, about a quick fix. It's about a long obedience. I pray that your Holy Spirit will take the truth, not for us alone, not for us alone, not for us alone, and will grind that into our hearts lovingly, just to rub it in like a seasoning. I'm asking for you to release conviction in this house like we've never known before. And that's redemptive. That's not condemnation. That's not judgment. But it's a conviction, so that we'll forsake those paths that we're leading people astray, and we'll walk with consistency. I'm asking that when people come, whether they understand it or have church background or not, that they'll sense the presence of the Lord and his direct speaking to their life, that they'll sing with that song that they wrote and we sang today, "Let's speak, Lord, for I'm listening to you." I pray your blessing upon each one. I pray that this will be a message that will just stay after us. Holy Spirit, use it. Not for us alone. Not for us alone. Not for us alone. May we be aware of the tracks that we're leaving. So we answer this call. And just before they sing, as we conclude, I just want to kind of hover here for a moment or two. And guys, just you talk to the Lord, just in your own way, and just say, "Speak, Lord. I'm listening." Could you do that right now? Just begin to sing that chorus softly, would you? That "Speak, Lord, I'm listening." Just stay in that posture. It's not a physical posture necessarily, but it's "Here I am." Remember, "Here I am." This is our conclusions.
"Speak, Lord, I'm listening.
Not going to hold you long. You always know that this is a place of prayer. I don't know where you have to be. I know you need to get your kids together, but I'm praying that you'll just come to a place of surrender. I don't know what that surrender is going to mean specifically, but the Lord will speak to you if you'll listen, and he longs to bless you in all you do. Not for us alone. Your blessings, Lord, over all these precious people. Amen. You're free to go if you need to pray and make a commitment to make a decision to deal with the surrender issue. You can do that. Just sing a little more, will you? Thank you for your patience.
Speak.